Hello everybody and welcome to video number 18 of the free online version of the Fusion Research Lecture. As you might remember, in the last video we talked about or started to talk about pressure-driven instabilities. So we are still in chapter 3, parameter limits for fusion plasmas. And in today's video we will dive deeper into that topic. And to be more precise, the topic of today's video is or are ballooning instabilities. Ballooning instabilities. Now, what are ballooning instabilities? So let's now say that we allow poloidally asymmetric modes. This is something new which we haven't allowed before. So we allow now poloidally asymmetric modes, meaning instead of having a psi being a function, well, with the mode numbers mn being just a function of r, psi now, I really have to practice this writing, I guess, as this letter. Mn is a function of r and theta. And the resulting modes or the corresponding modes are called ballooning modes. So it's ballooning modes. Oops. And on the left hand side, you can see an example for this. So here we have geometry. This is a poloidal cross section with a magnetic field gradient to the left. And here we have modes which have larger amplitude on the low magnetic field side, on the outboard side. So this is, as you remember from last time, the bad curvature region. So this is the bad curvature region. And on the high field side, it's the good curvature region, where we have modes with reduced amplitude, and so these are ballooning modes. Now, how to handle them? To describe them or their the resulting stability limits, we need to introduce a few quantities. So to get a proper description of the stability limit, we need to introduce two quantities, and the first one is the normalized pressure gradient. So the normalized pressure gradient, and this is alpha, defined as minus and then 2 mu naught r naught over b phi squared times qs squared times dp over dr, so the pressure gradient. So the left term, so this expression here basically includes the machine parameters. So we have the radius and the magnetic field and the safety factor. And this one basically is the destabilizing pressure gradient. In addition to the normalized pressure gradient, we need another quantity expression which you already know, which is the shear. The shear was defined as S being equal to R over QS and then DQS over DR. So these are the two important or the two quantities we need. And now if we apply the energy principle, so applying the energy principle yields, yields S alpha diagrams, which characterizing for each flux surface stability against those ballooning modes. So to say that again, the energy principle gives us an S-alpha diagram or S-alpha diagrams, which characterizes or which allows us to characterize for each flux surface the stability against the ballooning modes. Now let's have a look at that. First, to start with a circular plasma. Let's first start with a circular plasma. And when I say circular plasma, I of course refer to the poloid cross-section being circular. Yeah. So this is the diagram which you see on the right-hand side. You see S, so the normalized pressure, the shear, then as a function of the pressure gradient. And you see two type of regions. The non-shaded area, this is a region of stability, which is usually referred to as first stable region. Then we have a region of instability, which here is color-coded. I'm not sure if this is some kind of magenta, I guess. Sorry, I'm slightly colorblind, but I guess it's magenta. Then we have the second stable region, and as I said, in between is a region of instability. So the first stable region, which is characterized by small alpha. Small alpha means also small pressure gradient. So it's not surprising that we have a stable region there because the destabilizing forces are small then. So the first stable region is limited by a linear function by S equal to 1.67 alpha. So if you have a look on the drawing, the diagram, so here we can roughly draw a linear function. This corresponds to the parameter, to the function which I have written there on the left-hand side. Now there's also a second stable region, and that has instead large pressure gradient. So large normalized pressure gradient, large alpha, but small shear. Now, what does that mean? So let's briefly discuss that. Having a large pressure gradient means we have a large Shafranov shift. Having a large Shafranov shift now means that we have steep field lines on the low field side. Remember that discussion from a few videos ago. So this means we have steep magnetic field lines on the low field side. This means that the length in the good curvature region is longer or higher. The length in good curvature region is higher or longer of the magnetic field line. And this means that there's an overall increased influence of the good curvature region. Thus, we're getting an overall second region of stability there. Okay, that's it for a circular plasma, for a plasma having a circular poloid cross-section. Now, how can we change that? We can change that or extend that regions of stability by plasma shaping. So if we perform some plasma shaping, which basically means having a non-circular poloidal cross-section. This has positive effects. As you can see on the right-hand side. So now we can see that there is a dark purple area. This is the region of instability. And this is much smaller for a non-circular cross-section plasma than for the circular one. Remember, all this region here, which we had previously, has been previously instable or unstable for a circular plasma, now is stable. So we have increased now our parameter space where we can operate our plasma. And what happens is basically that we reduce, or the what we do basically by plasma shaping is that we reduce the field line length in the bed curvature region. For example, by triangular cross-sections, by bean-shaped cross-sections. So basically it's elongated along the vertical direction with the overall goal to reduce the field line length in the bad curvature region. So to get a higher influence of the good curvature region, thus increasing our accessible parameter space. Now, this leads us to the stability beta limit. The maximum achievable beta is in each experiment a subject of active research, as you can imagine, because beta, higher beta means a more efficient plasma device, a more efficient fusion device. For this reason, the maximum achievable beta in each experiment is a subject of active research. So to remember, just as a reminder, the beta maximum, beta is defined or was defined by the pressure, the normalized plasma pressure, the average plasma pressure. So here, since we want to have the maximized beta, it's also the maximized plasma pressure, then over the magnetic field pressure. Then we use the normalized parameters we introduced a few slides ago. So we use the normalized parameters introduced a few slides ago for comparing between experiments. That means we express the averaged pressure in terms of S and alpha. How does that look like? So let's write this down. So we start with P, the averaged pressure, plasma pressure, being 2 over A squared, where the factor of 2 is due to the fact that we have electrons and ions. Then A squared in the denominator is the normalization. Then we have the integral from the plasma boundary to the plasma center from 0 to A. Then PR, R times DR. And what we then perform is integration by parts. Integration by parts, making use of the fact that the plasma pressure at the boundary is defined as zero. And instead of writing every step down, I just write now the result down of the integration by parts, whereas I'm only missing here one step, so it's easy to do that on your own. So that I'm hiding something here. Minus 1 over a squared, 0 to a, then p prime, so the radial derivative of p, r squared dr. And now we finally insert the normalized values. Then we get in front of the integral, we have b phi squared over 2 mu naught r a squared, r not a squared, then the integral from 0 to a, and it's alpha r squared over qs squared dr. Okay, this is just another expression, not too useful, so we have to do one more step. And oops, I wanted to insert a page here. So we have to do one more step, and this is to insert the maximum pressure gradient in a circular cross-section plasma against ballooning instability, which we just deduced from our S alpha diagram. So what we now do is to use the knowledge about the maximum pressure gradient in a circular tokamak. And again, by circular tokamak, I mean a plasma having a circular poloidal cross section. Maximum pressure gradient in a circular tokamak, which is stable against ballooning instability, that was alpha being equal to s over 1.67 or 2/3 times s approximately. Inserting that yields for the maximum averaged pressure approximately b phi squared over 3 times mu naught r naught a squared, then the integral from 0 to a, then s r squared over qs squared dr. And this now allows us to write for the maximum beta value an expression which reads approximately 2 times over 3 a squared r naught squared, the integral from 0 to a, then qs prime, so the derivative with respect to the radius, qs to the power of 3 dr. And now we have an expression for the maximum beta value against ballooning instabilities. And if you have a close look, you realize something important, that writing it in this way, the maximum beta value depends only on QS. And this is why we also, or why this factor is also called a set safety factor, one of the reasons. Because this defines basically, or sets, if we have a stable plasma. If you get this higher, then yeah. Well, it tells us the maximum beta value we can achieve, writing it in this way. Now, okay, this is still just a formula. Now, what does this actually mean for actual values of the beta? So let's see what we can do trying to maximize beta. So we are now trying to get as large beta as possible. Oops, trying to maximize beta. And we do this with the radial profiles as given in this plot, where we have the plasma pressure, the safety factor, and the corresponding plasma current necessary to get the maximum beta. And what we set is a boundary condition is to the, we set the safety factor as a plasma boundary to be 3, which is then stable against external King instability plus the safety margin. And then we can calculate the resulting integral, which we had on the previous slide, which gives us a beta maximum of approximately 5.6 times IP, the plasma current, over A, the minor plasma radius, and B phi. Yeah, so we now have a formula to actually calculate the beta maximum. The units here are such that IP, the plasma current, is given in mega ampere, the magnetic field is given in Tesla, the minor plasma radius is given in meter, and beta is given in percentage. Okay, now these are ideal profiles with these step functions. It's of course unrealistic. Now, what happens if we go from ideal profiles to more realistic profiles, then we get a beta maximum of 2.8, then again times the plasma current over the minor radius and the magnetic field, B phi, this is supposed to be phi. So this is an important limitation. This is the the so-called Troyon limit, which we have written down here. This is the Troyon limit, important enough to give it a yellow box. The Troyon limit. And this is for a circular poloidal cross section plasma. And this value 2.8, which we have here in front, this is also abbreviated with beta n. And what is often used for comparing the beta values between different experiments is actually this value. So the normalized beta, something which we use often, or which is often used for comparison, and beta n is, as you can see there, defined by the actual achieved beta maximum in an experiment over IP over A, B, phi at the plasma center. Oops. So this is the normalized beta. Now let's have a look at the actually achieved values. Here you can see a diagram of the beta as a function of this normalized parameter. So I over the minor radius and the magnetic field strength. And you can see the achieved values. You can see there is a linear function along which the values order, so to say. So here, this one is a linear function where beta max is given as beta n times I over a b phi, and the beta n value, which we have here, so you can see it's 3.5, meaning it is higher than the value for which we got for circular cross-section plasmas, or circular cross-sections. Again, it shows us that it pays off to have plasmas with non-circular cross-section. Let's have a look again at the plot. You can see there are discharges from a few experiments where we actually exceed this 3.5, for example, here or here or here. These are strongly shaped plasmas where we have achieved very high beta values, kind of record values. You can also see that here at the bottom, so different colored regions correspond basically to different experiments. And in the beginning, the beta was very low, but then it started to increase. And as I said, shaping the plasma pays off because you get an overall higher beta. This is 3.5 instead of the 2.8, which was a Troyon limit. There is, however, another limitation for beta, and this is something we should definitely mention here. Apart from the ballooning instability, there is often a practical limitation hitting earlier, a practical limitation which you have to be aware of, and you can tackle it, but you have to be aware of, we can deal with it. And this is due to the NTM occurrence. Remember, neoclassical tiering modes is something you would like to avoid at a large scale experiment because it can lead to disruptions. And we talked about NTMs and how to deal with them. Just as a small remark here, there's often a practical limitation in terms of the maximum achievable beta due to the occurrence, the onset of NTMs at very high plasma pressures. Now to finish this video, a small reminder why beta is important. So before we come to the plot, a few introducing remarks. So the fusion power increases with plasma pressure. So it's good to have a high plasma pressure. Then the magnetic field times the volume is what sets the price of a fusion device. So this is what costs money. And for this region, we need to maximize beta for a commercial fusion power plant, for a commercial fusion plant. And this is indicated in the plot on the left-hand side, which shows the cost of electricity of a fusion power plant as a function of the beta. And as you can see, the higher the beta is, the cheaper the electricity is, the lower the costs are. And this is a nice illustration of why it pays off to have as high beta as possible. Okay, that's it for today's video, where we talked about ballooning instabilities, which are poloidally asymmetric modes. And to apply the energy analysis, we introduced the normalized pressure gradient and the shear. Then we got these S alpha diagrams telling us stable regions for each flux surface. And from that, we derived a stability beta limit. We came up with a Troyon limit for a circular cross-section plasma. However, all modern experiments achieved higher limits in terms of the normalized beta due to plasma shaping. And here on the last slide, we had a reminder on why it is worth to get the beta as high as possible, because it increases the cost of electricity. That's it. Hope to see you in the next video.